Nature crescent does not grow alone in thews and bulk, but as this temple waxes, the inward service of the mind and soul grows wide with all. Perhaps he loves you now, and now no soil nor coffel doth besmirch the virtue of his will, but you must fear his greatest weight is will is not his own, for he himself is subject to his birth. He may not, as unvalued persons do, carve for himself, for on his choice depends the safety and the health of this whole state. Then wait a loss your honor may sustain, if with to create an ear you list his songs, or lose your heart, or your chaste treasure open to us unmastered opportunity. Fear it, Ophelia, fear it, my dear sister, and keep you in the rear of your affection, out of the shot and danger of desire.
I shall the effect of this good lesson keep, as watchman to my heart. But, good my brother, do not as some ungracious pastors do, show me thorny way to heaven, whilst like a puffed and reckless libertine the primrose pass of Dalian's treads and recks not his own reed.
Oh, fear me not. I stayed too long, but here my father comes. A double blessing is a double grace. Occasion smiles upon a second leave.
Yet here, Laertes, aboard, aboard for shame. The wind sits in the shoulder of your sail, and you are safe for it. And these few precepts in thy memory look thou character. Give thy thoughts no tongue, nor any unproportioned thought his act. Be thou familiar, but by no means vulgar. Beware of entrance to a quarrel, but being in it, bear it that the posive may beware of thee. Give every man thy ear, but few thy voice. Take each man's censure, but reserve thy judgment. Costly thy habit, as thy purse can buy, but not expressed in fancy. Rich, not gaudy, for the peril oft proclaims the man. Neither borrower nor lender be, for loan oft loses both itself and friend, and borrowing dulls the edge of husbandry. This, above all, to thine own self be true. And it must follow, as the night to the day, thou canst not then be false to any man. Farewell. My blessing seasons this in thee.
Most humbly do I take my leave, my lord.
The time invests you. Go, your servants tend.
Farewell. And Ophelia, remember well what I've said to you.
'Tis in my memory locked, and you yourself shall keep the key of it.
Farewell.
What is it, Ophelia, that he hath said to you?
So please you, something touching the Lord Hamlet.
Very well methought. 'Tis told of me he hath very of late given private time to you, and you yourself of your audience have been most free and bounteous. What is between you? Give me up the truth.
He hath, my lord, of late made many tenders of his affection to me.
Affection? Huh, you speak like a green girl unsifted in such perilous circumstance. Do you believe his tenders, as you call them?
I do not know, my lord, what I should think.
Mary, I will teach you. Think yourself a baby, that you've taken these tenders for true pay, which are not sterling. Therefore, tender yourself more dearly, or, not to crack the wind of the poor phrase running it thus, you'll tender me a fool.
My lord, he hath importuned me with love and honorable fashion.
Fashion, go to, go to!
And given countenance to a speech with almost all of the holy vows of heaven.
Aye, springes to catch woodcocks. I do know when the blood burns how prodigal the soul lends the tongue vows. These blazes, daughter, you must not take for fire. From this time forth, be something scanter of your maiden As for Lord Hamlet, believe in him so much that he is young, and may walk with a longer tether than may be given you. From this time forth, I would not, in plain terms, have you so slander any moment leisure as to give words or talk with the Lord Hamlet. Come to, look your ways.
I shall obey, my lord.
Mark me.
I will.
My hour is almost come, when I to sulphurous and tormenting flames must render up myself.
Alas, poor ghost.
Pity me not, but lend thy serious hearing to what I shall unfold.
Speak, I am bound to hear.
I am thy father's spirit, doomed for a certain term to walk the night, and for the day confined to fast in fires, till the foul crimes done in my days of nature are burnt and purged away. List, list, oh list, if thou didst ever thy dear father love.
Oh God!
Revenge his foul and most unnatural murder.
Murder?
Murder most foul, as in the best it is, but this most foul, strange, and unnatural.
Haste me to know it, that I with wings as swift as meditation of the thoughts of love may sweep to my revenge.
I find thee apt. Now, Hamlet, here. 'Tis given out that, sleeping in my orchard, a serpent stung me. So the whole ear of Denmark is, by a forged process of my death, rightly abused. For no, thou noble serpent that had saved thy father's life, now wears his crown.
Oh, my prophetic soul, my uncle.
Ah, that incestuous, that adulterate beast, with witchcraft of his wit, with traitorous gifts. Oh, wicked wit and gifts that have the power so to seduce. One to his shameful loss, the will of my most seeming virtuous queen. But virtue, though it never will be moved, though lewdness courted in a shape of heaven, so lust, though to a radiant angel linked, will sate itself in a celestial bed and prey on garbage. hallways of the afternoon, upon my secure hour thy uncle stole, the juice of cursed Helena in a vial, and in the porches of my ears did pour the leprous distilling, whose effect holds such an enmity in blood of man that, swift as quicksilver, it courses through the natural gates and alleys of the body. Thus was I, sleeping by a brother's hand, of life, of crown, of queen at once dispatched. Cut off even the blossoms of my sin, unhouseled, disappointed, unannelled, no reckoning made, but sent to my account with all my imperfections on my head. Oh, horrible, most horrible. If thou hast nature in thee, bear it not. Let not the royal bed of Denmark be a couch for luxury and damned incest. But howsoever thou pursuest this act, hate not thy mind, nor let thy soul contrive against thy mother all. Adieu. 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 Remember me. Oh, all you hosts of heaven, O earth, what else? Remember me, I, thou poor ghost, whilst memory holds a seat in this distracted globe, remember me. Yea, from the tables of my memory I'll wipe away all trivial, fond records, all saws of books, all forms, all pressures past of youth and observation copied there. And thy commandment all alone shall live within the book and volume of my brain, unmixed with baser matter. Yes, by heaven! Oh, most pernicious woman! Oh, villain, villain, smiling, damned villain! My tables, neat it is I set it down that one may smile and smile and be a villain. At least I am sure it may be so in Denmark. So, uncle, there you are. Now to my word. It is adieu, adieu, remember me. I have sworn it.
My lord, how is my noble? What news, my lord?
Oh, wonderful.
Could my lord tell it?
No, you will reveal it.
Heaven, my lord, not I.
Nor I, my lord.
There's not a villain dwelling in all Denmark that is an hour indeed.
There needs no ghost, my lord, to come from the grave to tell us this.
Why, right. You are in the right, and so without more circumstance at all, I hold the figure, we shake hands and part. You is your business and desire to point you, for every man hath business and desire such as it is. And for my own poor part, I will go pray.
My lord, you do but wild and whirling words.
I am sorry to offend you heartily, yes, faith heartily.
There's no offense, my lord.
Yes, by Saint Patrick, but there is friendship. Touching this vision here, it is an honest ghost, that let me tell you. For your desire to know what is between us, or master it as you may, and now, good friends, as you are friends, scholars, and soldiers, give me one poor request.
What is it, my lord? We will.
Never make known what you have seen tonight.
My lord, we will not.
Nay, but swear it.
In faith, my lord, not I.
Nor I, my lord, in faith.
Upon my sword.
My lord, we have sworn already.
Indeed, upon my sword, indeed.
Swear!
Ah, boy, sayst thou so? Come on, you hear this fellow in the cellarage consent to swear.
Propose the oath, my lord.
Never to speak of this that you have seen. Swear by my sword.
Swear!
Come hither, gentlemen, and lay your hands upon my sword. Swear by my sword never to speak of this that you have heard.
Swear by this sword!
By day and night, but this is wondrous strange.
And therefore, as a stranger, give it welcome. There are more things in heaven and earth, Horatio, than are dreamt of in your philosophy. But come, here, as before, never, so help you mercy, how strange or odd some air I bear myself, as I perchance hereafter shall be meet to put an antic disposition on. But you, at such time seeing me, never shall with arms encumbered thus, or this head shaker by pronouncing some doubtful phrase of, well, oh, we know, and we could, and we would, or, if we list to speak, and mean, if there might be this ambiguous giving out to note that you know ought to be this, do swear. So grace and mercy at your most need help you.
Swear!
Rest, rest, perturbed spirit. So, gentlemen, if
all my love, I do commend me to you. Let us go in together. And still, your fingers on your lips, I pray. The time is out of joint. Oh, cursed spite, that ever I was born to set it right.
Something have you heard of Hamlet's transformation? What it should be, more than his father's death, that has put him so much from the understanding of himself I cannot dream of. I entreat you both that you vouchsafe your rest here in our court for some little time, so by your companies to draw him onto pleasures, and to gather from him as much for the occasion as you may glean. That, opened, lies within our remedy.
Good gentlemen, he hath much talked of you, and sure I am to men there is not living to whom he more adheres. If it will please you to show us so much gentry and goodwill as to expend your time with us a while for the supply and profit of our good hope, your visitation shall receive such thanks as fits a king's remembrance.
Both your majesties might, by the sovereign power you have of us, put your dread pleasures more into command than to entreaty.
But we both obey, and here give up ourselves in the full bent to lay our services freely at your feet to be commanded.
Thanks, Rosencrantz, and gentle Guildenstern.
Thanks, Guildenstern, and gentle Rosencrantz. And I beseech you instantly to visit my too much changed son.
Go, some of you, and bring these men where Hamlet is.
Heavens make our presence and practices pleasant and helpful to him.
Aye, amen.
My lord, the ambassadors from Norway are joyfully returned.
Thou still hast been the father of good news.
Have I, my lord? I assure you, I hold my duty as I hold my soul, both to my God and to my gracious king. And, else this brain of mine trods not the path of politics as it so used to. I do believe I have found the very cause of Hamlet's lunacy.
Oh, speak of that do I long to hear.
First, give admittance to the ambassadors. My news shall be the fruits to that great feast.
Self to grace to them and bring them in. He
tells me, my dear Gertrude, he hath found the head and source of all your son's distemper.
I doubt it is no other but the main, his father's death and our, or hasty marriage.
Well, we shall sift it. Welcome, my good friends. Say, Baltimant, what from our brother Norway?
Most fair return of greetings and desires. Upon our first, he sent out to suppress his nephew's levies, which to him appeared to be a preparation against the Polak, but better looked into, he truly found it was against your highness. Whereat griefs that his sickness, age, and impotence was falsely borne in hand, he sends out a rest on Fortinbras, which he in brief obeys, receives rebuke from Norway, and, in fine, makes vow before his uncle never more to give thee a save arms against your majesty. Whereon old Norway, overcome with joy, gives 60,000 crowns in annual fee, and his commission to employ those soldiers, so levied as before, against the Polak. With this entreaty herein further shown, that it might please you to give quiet pass through dominions for this enterprise, on such regards of safety and allowance as therein are set down.
It likes us well, and at a more considered time we'll read, answer, and think upon this business. Meantime, we thank you for your well to the labor. Go to your rest. At night we'll feast together. Most welcome home.
This business is well ended. Now, my liege and madam, to expostulate what majesty should be, what duty is, why day is day, night night, and time is time, were nothing but to waste night, day, and time. Therefore, since brevity is the soul of wit, and tediousness the outward limbs and flourishes, I will be brief. Your noble son is mad. Mad call I it, for to define true madness, what is it but to be nothing else but mad? But let that be.
More matter with less art?
Oh, madam, I use no art at all. That he's mad, tis true. Tis true. Tis pity and pity, tis true. Foolish figure. But look to it, for I will use no art. Mad, let us grant him then. Thus remains to find the cause of this effect, or rather, the cause of this defect. For effect defective comes by cause. Thus remains, and the remainder thus. Her pen. I have a daughter, have will she his mind, who in her duty and obedience hath given me this. Now, gather and surmise. To the celestial and my soul's love, the most beautified Ophelia, that's an ill phrase, a vile phrase. Beautified is a vile phrase, but you shall hear thus. In her excellent white bosom, these...
Came this from Hamlet to her?
Could madam stay a while, I will be faithful. Doubt that ere these the stars are fire, doubt that the sun doth move, doubt truth to be a liar, but never doubt I love. Oh, dear Ophelia, I am ill at these numbers. I have not art to reckon my groans, but that I love thee best, oh, most best, believe it. Adieu, thine evermore, most dear lady, whilst this machine is to him, Hamlet.
But how hath she received his love?
What do you think of me?
As of a man faithful and honorable.
I would fain prove so, but what might you think if upon seeing this hot love on the wing, I had played the desk or table book, or given my heart a winking, mute and dumb, or looked on this love with an idle sight? What might you think? No, I prescripts gave her that she should lock herself from his resort, which done, she took the fruits of my advice, and he, repelled, a short tale to make, fell into the madness wherein now he raves, and all we mourn for.
Do you think 'tis this? It may be very like.
How may we try further?
You know, sometimes he walks 4 hours together here in the lobby.
So he does indeed.
Such a time, I'll lose my daughter to him. Be you and I behind an heiress, then. Mark the encounter. If he love her not, let me be no assistant for the state, but keep a farm and carters.
We will try it.
But look where sadly the poor wretch comes reading.
Oh, leave, I do beseech you, leave. Oh, give me leave. How does the good Lord Hamlet?
Well, God a mercy!
Do you know me, my lord?
Excellent. Well, you are a fishmonger.
Not I, my lord.
Then I would you were so honest a man. Have you a daughter?
I have, my lord.
Let her not walk in the sun. Conception is a blessing, but as your daughter may conceive, friend, look to it.
How say you by this? Still harping on my daughter, yet he knew me not at first. He said I was a fishmonger. I'll speak to him again.
What do you mean, my lord?
Words.
Words? Words! What is the matter, my lord?
Between who?
I mean, the matter that you read, my lord.
Slander, sir. For the satirical rogue says here that old men have gray beards, that their faces are wrinkled, their eyes purging thick amber and plum tree gum, and that they have a plentiful lack of wit, together with most weak hands, all of which, sir, though I most powerfully and potently believe, yet I hold it not honesty to have it thus redoubted. For yourself, sir, should grow old as I am, if, like a crab, you could go backwards.
Well, this be madness, yet there is method in it.
Will you walk out of the air, my lord?
Into my grave?
Indeed, that is out there. I will take my leave of him, and suddenly contrive a means of me between him and my daughter.
My lord, I will take my leave of you.
You cannot, sir. Take from me anything that I will more willingly part with all. Except my life. Except my life. Except my life.
Oh, you go to seek the Lord Hamlet. There he is.
These tedious old fools.
My honored lord.
My most dear lord.
My excellent good friends. How dost thou? Guildenstern, Rosencrantz, good lads, how do you both?
As the indifferent children of the earth.
Happy in that we are not over happy, on fortune's cap we are not the very button.
Nor the soles of her shoe?
Neither, my lord.
And you dwell about her waist or in the middle of her favors.
Bathe her private we.
And the sacred parts of fortune? Oh, most true, she is a strumpet. What news?
None, my lord. But that the world's grown on us.
Then is doomsday near. But her news is not true. Let me question more in particular. What have you, my good friends, deserved at the hands of fortune that she sends you to prison hither?
Prison, my lord.
Denmark's a prison.
Then is the world one.
A goodly one, in which there are many confines, wards, and dungeons, Denmark being one of the worst.
We think it not so, my lord.
Why then, it is none to you. There is nothing either good or bad, but thinking makes it so. To me, it is a prison.
Why then, your ambition makes it one. 'Tis too narrow for your mind.
Oh God, I can be bounded in a nutshell and count myself a king of infinite space. Were it not that I have bad dreams.
Well, what dreams indeed are ambition?
The very nature of the ambitious is merely the shadow of a dream. The dream itself is but a shadow.
Truly, and I hold ambition of so airy and light a quality that it is but a shadow's shadow.
Well, then are our beggars' bodies and our monarchs and outstretched heroes the beggars' shadows. Shall we to the court? For by my fay, I cannot reason.
We'll wait upon you.
No such matter. I will not sort you with the rest of my servants, for to speak to you like an honest man, I am most dreadfully attended. But in the beaten way of friendship, what make you in Elsinore?
To visit you, my lord, no other occasion.
Beggar that I am, I'm even poor in thanks. And sure, dear friends, my thanks are too dear a halfpenny. Are you not sent for? Is it your own inclining? Is it a free visitation? Come, come, deal justly with me. Come, come, nay, speak.
What should we say, my lord?
Anything but to the purpose. You were sent for. And there's a kind of confession in your looks which your modesties have not craft enough to color. I know the good king and queen have sent for you.
To what end, my lord?
That you must teach me. But I conjure you, friends, by the constancy of our youth, by the obligation of our ever-preserved love, and by what more dear or better proposal in charge of all, be even and direct with me whether you were sent for or not. lovely hall not off.
My lord, we were sent for.
I will tell you why. So shall my anticipation prevent your discovery and your secrecy to the king and queen, won't know feather. I have of late, wherefore I know not, lost all my mirth, forgone all custom of exercise, and indeed it sits so heavily in my disposition. This goodly frame of the earth seems to me a sterile point. This most excellent canopy of the air appears grave or hanging firmament, this majestic roof threaded with golden fire. Why, it appeared nothing to me but foul, pestilent congregation of fables. What a piece of work is that? How noble and amazing, how infinite in faculties, informing, moving, how express and admirable, in action, how like an angel, in apprehension, how like a god. The beauty of the world, paragon of animals, and yet to me, what is this quintessence of dust? Man delights not me. No, nor woman neither, though by your smiling you seem to say so.
My lord, there was no such stuff in my heart.
Why did you laugh then when I said man delights not me?
To think, my lord, if you delight not in man, what length of entertainment the players shall receive from you? We coded them on the way, and hither are they coming to offer you service.
Be the place of king shall be welcome, and his majesty shall have tribute on me. What players are they?
Even those which you were wont to take such delight in, the tragedians of the city.
Do they hold the same estimation they did while I was in the city? Are they so followed?
No, indeed are they not.
It is not very strange, for my uncle is king of Denmark, and those that would make mouths with him on my father live maybe 20, 30, 50, 100 ducats apiece for his picture in little. S'blood, there is something in this more than natural if philosophy could find it out.
Speech, my good lord.
I heard thee speak me a speech once, but it was not acted, or if it was, not above once, for the play, as I remember, pleased not the million. 'Twas caviar to the general, but it was, as I received it, and those whose judgment cried in the top of mine, an excellent play, well digested in the scene, set down with as much modesty as cunning. One speech in it I chiefly loved. 'Twas Aeneas' tale to Dido, and thereabout of it, especially where he speaks of Priam slaughtered. If it live in your memory, begin at this line. Let me see. The rugged Pyrrhus, like the Hyrcanian beast. Oh, 'tis not so. It begins with Pyrrhus. Roasted in wrath and fire, and thus o'ersized with coagulate gore, with eyes like carbuncles, the hellish Pyrrhus, old grandsire Priam seeks. So, proceed you.
That was excellent, my lord, both in accent and in motion.
Anon he finds him, striking too short at Greeks. His antique sword, rebellious to his arm, lies where it falls, repugnant to command. Unequal matched, Pyrrhus at Priam drives, strikes wide, but with the whiff and wind of his fell sword, the unnerved father falls. Then senseless Ilion, seeming to feel this blow, with flaming top stoops to his base, and with a hideous crash, takes prisoner Pyrrhus' ear. For lo, his sword, which was declining on the milky head of reverend Priam, seemed in the air to stick. So, as a painted tyrant, Pyrrhus stood, and like a neutral to his will and matter, did nothing. But as we often see, against some storm, a silence in the heavens, the bold winds speechless, and the orb below as black and hushed as death. Anon the dreadful thunder doth rend the region, so, after Pyrrhus' pause, aroused vengeance sets him new to work. And never did the Cyclops' hammers fall on Mars' armor, forged for proof a turn, with less remorse than Pyrrhus' bleeding sword now falls on Priam. Out, out, thou strumpet fortune!
This is too long.
Shout to the barbers with your beard. Prithee, say on. He's for a jigger, tell a bawdreary sleeps. Say on, come to Hecuba.
But who? Ah, who had seen the Moblet Queen?
Moblet? I like that. Moblet is good. Moblet Queen is good.
Run barefoot up and down, threatening the flames with bison room, a clout upon that head where late the diadem stood, and for a robe about her lank and all Ortemid loins, a blanket in the alarm of fear caught up. Who this had seen, with tongue in venom steeped, against fortune's state would treason have pronounced. But if the gods themselves had seen her then, when she saw Pyrrhus make malicious sport in mincing with his sword her husband's limbs, the instant burst of clamor that she made, unless things mortal move them not at all, would have made milch the burning eye of heaven and passion in the gods.
Look how his face colors and he has tears in his eyes. I prithee, no more of this.
'Tis well. I'll have thee speak out the rest of this soon. Sir, will you see the players well bestowed? Look you, let them be well used, for they are the abstract and brief chronicles of the time. After your death, you were better have a bad epitaph than their ill report while you live. I'll take them in. Follow him, friends. We'll hear a play tomorrow. Dost thou hear me, old friend? Can you play the murder of Gonzago?
Aye, my lord.
You could, for a need, study a speech of some dozen or 16 lines which I would set down and insert in it, could you not?
Aye, my lord.
Follow that lord. And look you, mock him not. Gentlemen, I will leave you till night. You are welcome to Elsinore.
Good, my lord.
Aye, so. Goodbye to you. Ignorant and amaze indeed the very faculties of eyes and ears.
slays him to the quick, if he do blench, I know my course. The spirit I have seen be the devil. The devil of how I've seen the pleasing shape, yea, and perhaps out of my weakness and my melancholy, as he is very potent with such spirits, but uses me to damn me. I'll have ground more relative than this. The play's the thing, wherein I'll catch the conscience of the king.
Get from him why he puts on this confusion.
He does confess he feels himself distracted, but from what cause he will by no means speak.
Nor do we find him forward to be sounded, but with a crafty madness keeps aloof, and we would bring him on to some confession of his true state.
Did he receive you well?
Most like a gentleman.
But with most forcing of his disposition.
Did you assay him to any pastime?
Madam, it so fell out that certain players we o'erwrought on the way, of these we told him, and there did seem in him a kind of joy to hear of it. They are here about the court, and as I think, they have already ordered this night to play before him.
'Tis most true, and he did beseech me to entreat your majesty to hear and see the matter tonight.
With all my heart it doth much content me to hear him so inclined. Good gentlemen, give him a further edge and drive his purpose into these delights.
We shall, my lord.
Sweet Gertrude, leave us too, for we have here a sent for Hamlet hither, that he, as 'twere by accident, may hear affront Ophelia. We may gather from him if it be the affliction of his love or no that thus he suffers for.
I shall obey you. And for your part, Ophelia, I do hope that your good beauties be the happy cause of Hamlet's wildness. So do I hope your virtues may bring him to his wonted way again, to both your honors.
Madam, I wish it may.
Look, walk you here, Ophelia. Gracious, so please you. We will bestow ourselves. Here, read on this book. The show of such an exercise may color your loneliness. 'Tis too much proved that in this city we do so pious sugar or the devil himself.
Oh, 'tis too true how smart a lash this speech doth give my conscience.
I hear him coming. Let's withdraw, my lord.
Arms against
again. For to the noble mind, rich gifts wax poor when the giver proves unkind.
Are you honest?
My lord.
Are you fair?
What means your lordship?
That if you be honest and fair, your honesty should admit no discourse to your beauty.
Could beauty, my lord, have put our commerce in with honesty?
Aye, truly. The power of beauty will sooner transform honesty from what it is to a bawd than the force of honesty to translate beauty into his likeness. This was sometime a paradox, but now the time gives it proof. I did love you once.
Indeed, you made me believe so.
You should not have believed me. For virtue cannot so inoculate our old stock, but we shall relish of it. I loved you not.
I was the more deceived.
Get thee to a nunnery. I would still be a breeder of sinners. I am myself indifferent, honest, but yet I could accuse me of such things that it were better my mother had not borne me. I am very proud, revengeful, ambitious, with more offenses at my beck than I have thoughts to put them in, imagination to give them shape, or time to act them in. What did such fellows as I do crawling between earth and heaven? We are arrant knaves all. Believe none of us. Go thy ways to a nunnery. Where's your father?
At home, my lord.
Let the door be shut upon him that he may play the fool nowhere but in his own house. Farewell.
Oh, sweet heavens, help him.
If thou dost marry, I'll give thee this plague for thy dowry. Be thou as chaste as ice, as pure as snow, thou shalt not escape cowardly. Get thee to a nunnery. Or if thou wilt needs marry, marry a fool, for wise men know well enough what monsters you make of them. To a nunnery go, and quickly too, farewell.
Heavenly powers, restore him!
I have heard of your paintings too well enough. God hath given you one face, and you make yourselves another. You jig, you amble, you lisp. Nickname God's creatures and make your wantonness your ignorance. Go to. I'll know more on it. It hath made me mad. I say, we will have no more marriage. Those that are married already, all but one, shall live. The rest shall keep as they are. To a nunnery, go. Farewell.
Oh, what a noble mind is here o'erthrown. The courtiers, soldiers, scholars, eye, tongue, sword. Expectancy and rose of the fair state, the glass of fashion and the mold of form. The observed of all observers, quite down. And I, of ladies most deject and wretched that suck the honey from his music vows, now see that noble and most sovereign reason, like sweet bells jangled out of time and harsh. The unmatched form and stature of blown youth that blasted with ecstasy. Oh, woe is me to have seen what I have seen,
Love, his affections do not that way tend, nor what he spake, though it lacked form a little, was not like madness. There's something in his soul o'er which his melancholy sits on the rue. I have in quick determination thus set it down. He shall with speed to England for the demand of our neglected tribute. What think you on it?
My lord, do what you will.
How now, Ophelia? You need not tell us what the Lord Hamlet said. We heard it all.
And my lord, do what you will,
but if you hold it fit, after the play, have his mother all alone entreat him to show his grief, and I'll be placed in the ear of all their conference.
It shall be so. Madness and great ones must not on the watch go.
court, and the queen too, and presently. Go bid the players make haste. Will you two help to hasten them?
Aye, my lord.
What ho, Horatio!
Here, your lord, at my service.
Horatio, thou art e'en as just a man as e'er my conversation coped withal.
By your lord.
Do not think I flatter, for what advancement can I hope from thee that no revenue hast but thy good spirits to feed and clothe thee? Dost thou hear? Since my dear soul was mistress of her choice and could of men distinguish, her election hath sealed thee for herself. Give me that man that is not passion's slave, and I will wear him in my heart's core, aye, in my heart of heart as I do thee. Something too much of this. There is a play tonight for the king. One scene of it comes very near the circumstance which I have told thee of my father's death. I prithee, when thou seest that act of foot, even with the very comment of thy soul, observe my uncle. His occulted guilt do not itself unkennel in one speech. It is a damned ghost that we have seen, and my imaginations are as foul as Vulcan's stithy. Give him heedful note, for I mine eyes are rivet to his face, and after we will both our judgments join in censure of his seeming.
Oh, my lord, if he steals all the while of his playing and scape detected, I will give theft.
How fares my cousin Hamlet?
Excellent, well, in faith of the chameleon's dish. I, each the heir, promised crown. Who cannot feed capons so?
I have nothing with this answer, Hamlet. These words are not mine.
No, nor mine now. My lord, you played once in the university, you say?
I did, my lord, and was accounted a good actor.
What did you enact?
I did enact Julius Caesar. I was killed in the Capitol. Brutus killed me.
It was a brute part of him to kill so capital a calf there. Be the players ready.
Aye, my lord, this day upon your patience.
Come hither, my dear Hamlet, sit by me.
No, dear mother, fear's metal more attractive.
How do you mark that?
Lady, shall I lie in your lap?
No, my lord.
I mean my head upon your lap.
Aye, my lord.
What do you think I meant? Cheerfully, my
full 30 times hath Phoebus' cart gone round Neptune's salt wash and Pellas' orbit line. And 30 dozen moons with borrowed sheen about the world and has 12 30 then since love our hearts, behind it that our heads unite the mutual in most sacred hands.
So many journeys, may the sun and the moon may us again come to our ere love. Woe is me, you are so sick of fate, so far from cheer and from your former state that I distrust you. Yet all I distrust is comfort you, my lord, in nothing less. The one is creator and law, but quantity, and neither art nor necessity. Now as my love is, proof that I've made you know, and as another sighs my fear is so.
Faith. It's not strange that even our loves should have our fortunes changed. So think thou wilt have second husband, but die thy love, and thy first love.
Nor earth to give thee food, nor heaven light. Sport and repose not from day and night. Opposite the place and face of joy, meet what I would have that and it destroy. Both here and hence pursue me lasting.
Tis deeply sworn. Sweet, leave me for a while. My spirits grow dull. Fain I would beguile tedious days.
Sleep, rock thy way, and never let a mischance be us.
Madam, how like you this play? The lady doth protest too much, methinks.
No, she'll keep her word.
Have you heard the argument? Is there no offense in it?
No, no offense in the world. They do a jest, poison and jest.
What do you call this play?
The Mousetrap, very out of trouble. The play is the image of a murderer done in Vienna. Gonzalo is seducing his wife, Baptista. It is a knavish piece of work, but what of that? Your Majesty and we that have free souls, it touches us not. This is one Lucianus, nephew to the king.
As good as a course, my lord.
I can interpret between you and your love if I can see the puppets.
Tally. You are keen, my lord, you are keen.
It costs you a groaning to take off my head.
Still better and worse.
So you mistake your husband's. Come, murderer, come begin. The croaking raven doth bellow for revenge. He poisons him. Garden for his estate. His name's Gonzago. The play is extant and written in very choice Italian. You shall see anon how the murderer gets the love of Gonzago's wife.
The king rises.
What frightened false fire.
How fares my lord?
Before the play,
give me some lights away.
Lights! 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 Lights!
Oh, good Horatio, I'll take the ghost word for £1,000. Upon talk of the poisoning.
I did very well.
Aha! Come, some music, come, the recorder. For if the king like up the comedy, why then belike he likes an opera. Come, some music.
Good, my lord, vote chief.
May a word with you.
Sir, the whole history.
The king, sir.
My sir, what of him?
In retirement, marvelous distempered.
With drink, sir?
No, my lord, with collar.
Your wisdom should perhaps do better to signify this to a doctor. Or for me, to put him to his purgation might perhaps plunge him into more choler.
Good, my lord, put your discourse into some other frame and start not so wildly for my affair.
I am tame, sir.
Pronounce. The queen, your mother, in most great affliction of spirit, hath sent me to you.
She desires to speak with you in her closet ere you go to bed.
We shall obey, were she 10 times our mother. Have you any further trade with us?
My lord, you once did love me.
And do still by these pickers and stealers.
Good my lord, what is your cause of distemper? You do surely bar the door upon your own liberty if you deny your griefs to your friends.
Sir, I lack advancement.
How can that be, when you have the voice of the king himself for your succession in Denmark?
Aye, but while the grass grows, the proverb is something musty. Will you play upon this pipe?
My lord, I cannot.
I pray.
With me, I cannot.
I do beseech you.
I know no touch of it.
It is as easy as lying. Govern these vantages with your fingers and thumb. Give it breath with your mouth, and it will discourse most eloquent music. Look you, these are the stops.
But this cannot. I cannot. And with any utterance of harmony, I have not the skill.
Why then? Look you how unworthy a thing you make of me. You would play upon me. You would seem to know my stops. You would pluck out the heart of my mystery. You would sound me from my lowest note to the top of my compass. And there is much music. Excellent voice in this little organ. If cannot you make it speak?
S'blood, do you think I am easier to be played upon than a pipe?
Call me what instrument you will, though you can fret me, you cannot play upon me. God save you, sir.
My lord, the queen would speak with you in her closet and presently.
Do you see on cloud that's almost in shape of a camel?
Indeed, my lord, 'tis like a camel.
And methinks it is like a weasel.
'Tis backed like a weasel.
Or
very
like a whale. Then I will come to my mother by and by. They fool me to the top of my bent. I will come by and by.
I will say so.
By and by is easily said. Leave me, friends. Tis now the very witching time of night. And churchyards yawn and hell itself breathes out contagion to this world. Now could I drink hot blood and do such bitter business as the day would quake to look on. Soft you, now to my mother. O heart, lose not thy nature. Let never the soul of Nero enter this firm bosom. I must be cruel, not unnatural. I will speak daggers to her, but use none. My tongue and soul in this be hypocrites. How in my words some ever she be shent, to give them seals never my soul consent.
He will come to his mother's closet. If she find him not, to England send him.
Thank you, my dear lord. Oh, my offense is rank. It smells to heaven. It hath the primal eldest curse on its brother's murder. Pray, can I not? Though inclination be as sharp as will, my stronger guilt defeats my strong intent. And I, like a man to double business bound, will stand and pause where I shall first begin and both be left. What if
This hand were thicker than itself with brother's blood. Is there not rain enough in the sweet heavens to wash with white as snow? Then I'll look up. My fault is past. What form of prayer can serve my turn? Forgive me my foul murder. That cannot be, since I am so possessed of those effects for which I did the murder. My crown, mine own ambition, is my queen. What then? What rests? Try what repentance can, what can it not? Yet what can it when one cannot repent? Oh, wretched state! Oh, bosom black as death! Oh, limed soul struggling to be free, art more engaged. Help, angels, make a say! Bow stubborn knees, and heart with strings of steel, be soft as sinews of a newborn babe. All may be well.
Now might I do it, Pat. Now he is praying. And now I'll do it! And so he goes to heaven. And so am I revenged. That would be scanned. A villain kills my father, and for that, I, his sole son, do this same villain send to heaven. Why, this is higher in salary, not revenge. He took my father from the blossoms of his sin, with all his crimes broad blown as flush as May. And how his audit stands, who knows, save heaven? And am I then revenged to take him in the purging of his soul when he is fit and seasoned for his passage? Up, sword, and know thou a more horrid hent. When he is drunk asleep, or in his rage, or in the incestuous pleasure of his bed, a game, a swearing, or about some act that hath no relish of salvation in it, then trip him, that his heels may kick at heaven, and his soul may be as damned and black as hell where to it goes. My mother stays. This physic but prolongs thy sickly days.
My words fly up, my thoughts remain below. Words without thoughts never to heaven go.
Thank you.
Look, you lay home to him. I will silence thee even here. Pray you be round with him.
Mother! Mother! Mother!
I'll warrant you, fear me not. Withdraw, I hear him coming.
Now, mother, what's the matter?
Hamlet, you have thy father much offended.
Mother, you have my father much offended.
Come, come, you answer with an idle tongue.
Go, go, you question with a wicked tongue.
Why, how now, Hamlet?
What's the matter now?
Have you forgot me?
No, by the rood, not so. You are the queen, your husband's brother's wife. And would it were not so, you are my mother.
Nay, then I'll set those to you that can speak.
Sit you down. You shall not budge, you go not till I hold you up a glass where you may see the inmost part of you.
What wilt thou do? Thou wilt not murder me? Help! Ho! Ho! Help!
How now? A rat? Dead, for a ducat, dead!
Oh, I am slain!
Oh me, what hast thou done?
Say, I know not, is it the king?
What a rash and bloody deed is this?
Bloody deed, almost as bad, good mother, as kill a king and marry with his brother.
As kill a king?
My lady, that was my word. Thou wretched, rash, intruding, oh, farewell. I took thee for thy better. Take thy fortune. Thou find'st me too busy as some danger. Leave wringing of your hands, peace. Sit you down and let me wring your heart. For so I shall, if it be made of penetrable stuff, if damned custom have upraised it so that it be proof and bulwark against sense.
What have I done that thou durst wag thy tongue in noise so rude against me?
Such an act that blurs the grace.
blush of modesty, calls virtue hypocrite, takes off the rose from the fair forehead of an innocent love, and sets a blister there, makes marriage vows as false as dicers of
I mean, what act that roars so loud and thunders in the index?
Look here upon this picture, and on this, the counterfeit presentment of two brothers. See what a grace was seated on this brow. Hyperion's curls, the front of Jove himself, an eye like Mars to threaten and command, a station like the herald Mercury new lighted on a heaven-kissing hill. This was your husband. Heck you now with follies. Here is your husband, like a mildewed ear blasting his wholesome brother. Ha! Have you eyes? You cannot call it love, for at your age the heyday in the blood is tame. It's simple and waits upon the judgment. And what judgment would stoop from this to this? Oh, shame! Where is thy blush? Rebellious hell, if thou canst mutine in a matron's bones to flaming youth, let virtue be as wax and melt in her own fire!
Hamlet, thou turn'st my eyes into my very soul, and there I see such black and braided spots as will not leave their taint.
Nay, but to live in the rank sweat of an ensemined bed, honeying and making love over the nasty sty.
Oh, no more, sweet Hamlet, these words like daggers enter my ears.
A murderer and a villain, a slave that is not 20th part the tithe of your precedent born, a vice of kings, a cut purse of the empire and the rule that from a shelf the precious diadem stole and put it in his pocket.
No more!
A king of shreds and patches! Save me and hover o'er me with your wings, you heavenly guards. How does your gracious figure?
Alas, is mad.
Do not come your tardy son to chide that lapsed in time and judgment lets go by the important acting of your dread command. Oh, say!
Do not forget, this visitation is but to whet thy almost blunted purpose. But look, amazement on thy mother sits. Oh, step between her and her fighting soul. Speak to her, Hamlet.
How is it with you, lady?
Alas, how is it with you? That you do turn your eye on vacancy, and with the incorporeal air do hold discourse, for that your eyes are spirits wildly deep. Gentle son, upon the heat and flame of thy distemper, sprinkle cool patience.
Him, look you how pale he glares. His form and cause conjoined, preaching to stones would make them capable. Do not look upon me, lest with this piteous action you convert my stern effects. And what I do will want true color, tears perchance for blood.
To whom do you speak this?
Do you see nothing there?
No, nothing. Yet all that is I see.
Or did you nothing hear?
No, nothing but ourselves.
Why look you now? Look, my father, in his habit as he lived. Look where he goes even now out of the portal.
This is the very coinage of your brains. This bodiless creation ecstasy is very cunning in.
Ecstasy? My pulse as yours doth temperately keep time and makes as healthful music. Mother, for love of God, lay not that flattering unction to your soul that not your trespass but my madness speaks. Will but skin and film the ulcerous place, whilst rank corruption mining all within infects unseen. Confess yourself to heaven. Repent what's past, avoid what is to come, and do not spread the compost on the weeds to make them ranker. Forgive me this, my virtue. For in the fatness of these pursy times, virtue of vice must pardon beg, yea, curb and woo for leave to do him good.
Oh, Hamlet, thou hast left my heart in twain.
Then live the purer with the other half. Good night. Go not to my uncle's bed. Assume a virtue if you have it not. Refrain tonight, and that shall lend a kind of easiness to the next abstinence, the next more easy. Once more, good night. And when you are desirous to be blessed, all blessing beg of you. For this same Lord, I do repent me, that heaven hath pleased it so to punish me with this and this with me, that I must be their scourge and minister? I will answer well the death I gave him. So again, good night. That must be cruel only to be kind. This bad begins, and worse remains behind.
What should I do?
Not this. By no means that I bid you to. Let the bloat king tempt you again to bed, pinch wanton on your cheek, call you his mouse, and for a pair of reachy kisses or paddling in your neck with his damned fingers, make you to ravel all this matter out, that I essentially am not in madness, but mad in craft. 'Twere good you let him know. For who, that's what a queen, fair, sober, wise, would from a paddock, from a bath, a jib, such dear concernings hide? Who would do so?
Be thou assured, if words be made of breath and breath of life, I have no life to breathe what thou hast said to me.
I must to England. You know that.
Alack. I forgot. 'Tis so concluded on.
There's letters sealed, and my two schoolfellows, whom I will trust as I will adders famed, they bear the mandate. They must sweep my way and marshal me to knavery. This man shall set me packing. I'll lug the guts into the neighbor room. Mother, good night indeed. This counselor is now most still, most secret, and most grave, who was in life a foolish, prating knave. Come, sir, to draw towards an end with you. Good night, mother.
My lord, you must tell us where sent to seek him and to find the body. How dangerous it is that this man goes loose. How now, what hath befallen?
Where the dead body is bestowed, my lord, we cannot get from him.
But where is he?
Without, my lord, guarded to know your pleasure.
Bring him before us.
Ho! Bring in the lord!
Now, Hamlet, where is Polonius?
At supper.
At supper where?
Not where he eats, but where he is eaten. A certain convocation of politic worms are in that. A man may fish with the worm that hath eat of the king, and eat of the fish that hath fed of that worm.
What dost thou mean by this?
Nothing, but to show you how a king may go a progress through the guts of a beggar.
Where is Polonius?
In heaven? Send thither to see. If your messenger find him not there, go seek him in the other place yourself. But if indeed you find him not within the month, you shall nose him as you go up the stairs into the lobby.
Go seek him there.
He will stay till you come.
Hamlet, prepare yourself. Bark is up and everything is bent for England.
For England?
Aye, Hamlet.
Good.
So is it if thou knewest our purposes?
I see a cherub that sees them. But come, for England, my loving mother.
Thy loving father, Hamlet.
My mother. Father and mother is man and wife. Man and wife is one flesh, and so my mother. Come, for England.
Follow him at foot, tempt him with speed aboard, I pray you haste. And England, if my love thou holdest that art, thou mayst not coldly set our sovereign process, which imports at full the present death of Hamlet.
Greet the Danish king, and tell him by his license, Fortinbras craves the conveyance of a promised march over his kingdom. Do you know the rendezvous?
I will do it, my lord.
Go softly, Helm.
Whose powers, sir, are these?
They are of Norway, sir.
How purpose, sir, I pray you?
Against some part of Poland.
Who commands them?
The nephew to old Norway, Fortinbras.
Goes it against the main of Poland or for some frontier?
Truly to speak, and with no addition, we go to gain a little patch of ground that hath in it no profit but thy name. To pay 5 ducats, 5, I will not farm it, nor will it yield to Poland or Norway. A rankery, should it be sold in fee?
The Pollock never will defend it.
Yes, it is already garrisoned.
2,000 men and 20,000 ducats will not debate the question of this straw. I humbly thank you, sir.
God bless you, sir.
Will it please you go, my lord? I'll be with you straight. Go a little before. How all occasions do inform against me and spur my dull revenge. What is a man if his chief good and market of his time be but to sleep and feed? A beast no more. Sure, he that made us in such large looking before and after gave us not that capability of godlike reason to foster us unused. Now, whether in bestial brilliance or some craven scruple of thinking too precisely on the event, upon which quarter but one part of wisdom and ever 3 parts coward, I do not know, but yet I live to say this thing is to do, since I have cause and will and strength and means to do it. Examples gross as earth. Is this army in such mass and charge, led by a delicate and tender prince, whose spirit with divine ambition puff makes mouths of the invisible event, exposing what is mortal and unsure to all that fortune, death, and danger dare, even for an eggshell? Rightly to be great is not to stir without great argument, but greatly to find more.
I will not speak with her.
She is importunate, indeed distraught. Her move will needs be pity.
What would she have?
She speaks much of her father, says she hears there's tricks in the world, hems and beats her heart, spurns enviously at straws, and speaks things in doubt that carry but half sense. Her speech is nothing, yet the unshaped use of it doth move the hearers to collection. They aim at it, and botch the words up to fit their own thoughts, which as her winks and nods and gestures yield them, would make one think there might be thought. Though nothing sure, yet much unhappily.
'Twere good she were spoken with, for she may strew dangerous conjectures and ill-bred minds.
Let her come in. So full of artless jealousy is guilt, it spills itself in fearing to be spilt.
Where's the beauteous majesty of Denmark?
How now, Ophelia?
How should I a true love know from another one? His cockle hat and staff and his sandal shoe.
Ah, sweet lady, what imports the song?
Say you? Nay, pray you, mark! He is dead and gone, lady, he is dead and gone. His head a grass green turf, and his heels a stone. Oh ho!
Nay, but Ophelia!
Pray you, mark!
Last look here, my lord.
Did not go.
How do you, pretty lady?
Well, God dilled you. They say the owl is the baker's daughter. Lord, we know what we are, but not what we may be. God be at your table.
Concede upon her father.
Pray! Let's have no worse of this. But when they ask you what it means, say this. Tomorrow is Saint Valentine's Day, all in the morning of time. And I am made at your window to be your valentine. And up he rose and donned his clothes and up the chamber door. Let in the maid that out of maid never departed more.
Pretty Ophelia.
Indeed, without an oath, I'll make an end to it. By kissing my Saint Charity, alack and fie for shame. Young men will do it, if they go to it. By cock, they are to blame! Quoth she, before you tumble me, you promise me to wear. He answers, so would I have done, by a song. But that my bed.
How long has she been thus?
I hope all will be well. We must be patient. But I cannot choose but weep to think they would lie him in the cold ground. My brother shall know of it. And so I thank you for your good counsel. Come, my coach. Good night, ladies. Sweet ladies, good night. Good night.
Follow her close, I pray you. Oh, this is the poison of deep grief. It all springs from her father's death, and now behold, oh, Gertrude.
Where is the king?
Alack, what noise is this?
Oh, thou vile king, give me my father!
Calmly, good Laertes.
That drop of blood that's calm proclaims thee bastard! Christ cuckold to my father! Prince the harlot even here, between the chaste unsmirched brow of my true mother!
Let him go, Gertrude. Laertes, do not fear our person. There's such divinity.
Where's my father?
Dead.
But not by him.
Let him demand his fill.
How came he dead? I'll not be juggled with. To hell, allegiance vows to the blackest devil, conscience and grace to the profoundest pit. To this point I stand that both worlds I give to negligence. Let come what comes, only I'll be revenged most thoroughly for my father.
I am guiltless of your father's death, and most sensibly in grief.
Oh, he. Tears dry, burn out the seven senses. O Rose of May, dear maid, kind sister, sweet Ophelia. Oh, heavens, is it life should be as mortal as an old man's life. Documented madness, thoughts, and remembrance fitted.
There's fennel for you. And columbines. There's rue for you. And here's some for me. We may call it the herb of grace on Sundays. You must wear your rue with a difference. Here's a daisy. I would give you violets, but they all withered when my father died. They say he made a good end. For Bonnie Sweet Robin is all my joy.
Thought and affliction, passion, hell itself. She turns to favorite to prettiness.
And will he not come again? And will he not come again?
No, no.
He is dead. Go to thy deathbed.
His beard was white as snow.
All flaxen was his wool.
And we cast away his moan.
God have mercy on his soul.
And on all Christian souls, I pray God. God be with you!
Must commune with your grief for you deny me right. I pray you go with me.
Finding ourselves too slow of sail, we put on a compelled valor, and in the grapple I boarded them. On the instant, they got clear of our ship, so I alone became their prisoner. They have dealt with me like thieves of mercy, but they knew what they did. I am to do a good turn for them. Let the king have the letters I have sent, and repair thou to me with as much speed as thou wouldst fly death. I have words to speak in thine ear will make thee dumb. Yet are they much too light for the bore of the matter? These good fellows will bring thee where I am. Rosencrantz and Guildenstern hold their course for England. Of them I have much to tell thee. Farewell. He, if thou knowest, thine.
Now must your conscience, my good, and seal, and you must put me in your heart for friends. Then have you heard with no ear that he which hath your noble father slain pursued my love? Well, Pierce.
And so have I a noble father lost. A sister driven into desperate terms, whose work he prays to make good back again, should challenge her own mount of all the age for her protection. When my revenge will come.
Break not your sleeps for that. I loved your father as we love ourselves. And that I hope will teach you to imagine.
How now? What news?
A letter, my lord, from Hamlet.
From Hamlet? Who brought them?
Sailors, my lord, they say. I saw them not.
Laertes, you shall fear. Leave us. Aye, Maya, you shall know I am set naked on your kingdom. Tomorrow shall I beg leave to see your king in the eyes, when I shall, just asking your pardon, thereunto recount the occasion of my sudden and more strange return to Hamlet. What should this mean? Are all the rest come back, or is it some abuse and no such thing?
Know you the hand?
'Tis Hamlet's character, naked in a postscript here, he says alone. Can you advise me?
I am lost in it, my lord. But let him come. It warms the very sickness in my heart to know that I shall live and tell him to his teeth, thus didst thou.
If it be so, Laertes, will you be ruled by me?
Aye, my lord, so you will not rule me to a peace.
To thine own peace. If he be returned, I will work him into an exploit. Now, ripen my device, under the which he shall not choose but fall. And for his death, no wind of blame shall breathe, but even his mother shall uncharge the practice and call it accident.
My lord, I will do it. The rather if you could devise it so that I might be the organ.
Laertes, was your father dear to you? Or are you like the painting of a sorrow, a face without a heart?
Why ask you this?
Not that I think you did not love your father, but that I know love is begun by time, and that I see in passages of proof the spark and fire of it. Hamlet comes back. What will you undertake to show yourself indeed your father's son more than in words?
To cut his throat in the church!
No place indeed should murder sanctuarize. But good way, Laertes, will you do this? Keep close within your chamber. Hamlet return shall know you are come home. We'll put on those shall praise your excellence, for art and exercise in your defense, and for your rapier, most especial. Bring you and find together, and a wager on your heads. He, being amiss, will not peruse the foils. So that you may choose a sword unbated and requite him for your father.
My lord, I will do it. And for that purpose, I'll anoint my sword. I bought an unction of a mountebank so mortal that nothing under the moon can save the thing from death that is but scratched withal. I'll touch my point with this contagion that, if I gall him slightly, it may be death.
Let's further think on this. I have it. When in your motion you are hot and dry, and as he calls for drink, I'll have prepared for him a chalice for the knots, whereon but sipping, if he by chance escape your venom struck, our purpose make old there. But stay, what noise?
One woe doth tread upon another's heels so fast they follow. Your sister's drowned, Laertes.
Oh, where?
There is a willow grows ascant the brook that shows his hoar leaves in the glassy stream. Thereon the pendant bough her corned weeds clambering to hang upon an envious sliver brook, and down her weedy trophies and herself fill in the weeping brook. And long it could not be to let her garments, heavy with their drink, pulled her from her melodious lay to muddy death.
Thank you.
Is she to be buried in Christian burial when she willfully seeks her own salvation?
I tell thee, she is. Therefore, make her grave straight. The crowner hath set on her and finds it Christian burial.
How can that be unless she drowned herself in her own defense?
Why, 'tis found so.
I must be say off and bendo. It cannot be else. For here lies the point. If I drown myself wittingly, it argues an act. An act hath three branches, to act, to do, to perform. Argal, she drowned herself wittingly.
Nay, but hear you, good man Delver.
Give me leave. Here lies the water. Good. Here stands the man. Good. If the man go to this water and drown himself, it is willy-nilly he goes. If the water go to him and drown him, he drowns not himself. Argal, he that is not guilty of his own death shortens not his own life. I'll put another question to thee. If thou answerest me not to the purpose, confess thyself.
Go to.
Who is it that builds stronger than either the mason, the shipwright, or the carpenter?
The gallows maker, for that frame outlives 1,000 tenants.
Aye, I like thy wit well. The gallows does well, but how does it well? It does well to those who do ill. Now, thou dost ill to say the gallows is but stronger than the church. Our gallows may do well to thee. To it again come.
Who builds stronger than a shipwright, a carpenter, or a mason?
Aye, tell me that, an unyoke?
Marry, now I can tell.
To it?
Mass I cannot tell.
Cudgel thy brains no more about it. For your doll ass will not mend his pace with thee. And when you are asked this question next, say, a grave maker. The houses he makes last till doomsday. Go, get thee in and fetch me a stoop of liquor. In youth, when I did love you,
does this fellow know feeling of his business? He sings in grave making.
Custom hath made it a property of easiness in him.
It is even so. The hand of little employment hath attained to your sense. What skull had a tongue in it and could sing once? How the knave jowls it to the ground as if it were Cain's jawbone that did the first murder. Why, this might be the pate of a politician which this ass now o'erreaches. That would circumvent God, but it not.
My lord.
Or of a courtier, which could say, how dost thou, sweet lord? Good morrow, sweet lord. Oh, this might be my lord such a one, who praised my lord such a one's horse when he went to beg it. Might it not?
Aye, good my lord.
I will speak to this fellow. Whose grave is this, sirrah?
Mine, sir.
I think it be thine indeed, for thou liest in it.
For you do not lie out on it, yet 'tis not yours. For my part, I lie in it, yet 'tis mine.
Thou dost lie in it to be in it and say it is thine. 'Tis for the dead, not for the quick, therefore thou liest.
'Tis a quick lie, sir. 'Twill away again from me to you.
What man dost thou dig it for?
For no man, sir.
What woman, then?
For none either.
Who is to be buried in it?
For one that was a woman, but rest her soul, she's dead.
How absolute the knave is! We must speak by the card, or equivocation will undo us. How long hast thou been gravemaker?
Of all the days in the year, I came to it that day our last King Hamlet overcame Fortinbras.
How long is that since?
Cannot you tell that? Every fool can tell that. It was that very day young Hamlet was born. He that is mad and is sent into England?
Aye, marry. Why was he sent into England?
Why, because he was mad. He shall recover his wits there, or if he do not, 'tis no great matter there.
Why?
'Twill not be seen in him there. There the men are as mad as he.
How came he mad?
Very strangely, they say.
How strangely?
Faith, even with losing his wits.
Upon what ground?
Why, here. In Denmark? I have been sexton, man and boy, 30 years.
How long will a man lie in the earth ere he rot?
Faith, if he not be rotten before he die, as we have many pocky horses these days that scarce hold a lane, he will last some 8 or 9 year. A tanner will last you 9 year.
Why he more than another?
Why, sir, his hide is so tanned with his trade,
that you will keep out water a great while. And your water is a sore decayer of your horse and dead body. Here's a skull.
I lay you in the earth some 23 years.
Whose was it?
A horse and mad fellow's it was. Who do you think it was?
Nay, I know not.
The pestilence went him for a mad room. He poured a flagon of brainish on my head once. This skull, sir, was Sir Yorick's skull, the king's young jester.
This?
Even that.
Let me see it. Alas, poor Yorick. I knew him, Horatio. A fellow of infinite jest, of most excellent fancy. But he hath borne me on his back 100 times, and now, how abhorred in my imagination it is. My gorge rises at it. Here hung those lips that I have kissed I know not how oft. Where be your jibes now, your gambols, your songs, your flashes of merriment that were wont to set the table on a roar? Not one now to mock your own grinning, quite chapfallen. Now, get you to my lady's chamber, and tell her let her paint an inch thick. To this favor she must come. Make her laugh at that. For thee, Horatio, tell me one thing.
What's that, my lord?
Dost thou think Alexander looked o' this fashion in the earth?
Even so.
And smelt so.
Even so, my lord.
So what base uses we may return, Horatio. Why might not imagination trace the noble dust of Alexander till he find it stopping a bunghole?
Were too curious to consider so.
No, faith, not a jot, but to follow him thither with modesty enough and likelihood to lead it, as thus Alexander died, Alexander was buried, Alexander returneth to earth. The dust is earth, of earth we make loam, and why of that loam whereto he was converted, might they not stop a beer barrel? Imperious Caesar, dead and turned to clay, might stop a hole to keep the wind away. But soft a while. Here comes the king, the queen, the courtiers. Who is this they follow, and with such beaming rites? For this doth betoken the course they follow did with desperate him do its own life. It was of some estate, couch we a while and mark.
Have been far enlarged as we have warned you. Her death was doubtful, and in but that great command owes me the order, she should in ground unsanctified been lodged to the last trumpet. For charitable prayers, shards, flints, and pebbles should be thrown on her, yet here she is allowed her virgin crans, her maid instruments, and the bringing home of bell and burial.
Must there no more be done?
No more be done. We should profane the service of the dead and sing a requiem and such to rest as to peace parted souls.
Laeramir, and from her fair and unpolluted flesh may violence spring. I tell thee, churlish priest, a ministering angel shall my sister be while thou liest howling.
What, the fair Ophelia?
Sweet to the sweet, farewell.
I had hoped thou shouldst defend my Hamlet's wife. Thought thy bride bed to have decked sweet maid and not have strewed thy grave.
Oh, treble woe! Full 10 times treble on the cursed head whose wicked deed thy most ingenious sense deprived thee of. Hold off the earth a while, till I've got her once more in mine arms.
What is he whose grief bears such an emphasis? Whose phrase of sorrow conjures the wandering stars and makes them stand like wonder-wounded hearers. This is I, Hamlet the Dane.
The Devil take thy soul!
Thou prayst not well.
I would thee take thy fingers from my throat. Though I am not spleenive and rash, I've in me something dangerous which let thy wisdom fear. Hold off thy hand, pluck them aside.
Hamlet! Hamlet, good my lord, be quiet.
Why, I will fight with him upon this theme until my eyelids will no longer wag.
And my son, what theme?
I loved Ophelia. 40,000 brothers with all their quantity of love could not make up my sum. What would thou do for her?
Oh, he's mad, Laird.
For love of God, forbear him. Swoons, tell me what thou do. Would drink, up Isle, would fight, would fast, would tear thyself, would eat a crocodile? I'll do it. Dost thou come here to whine, to outface me with leaping in her grave? Be buried quick with her, and so will I. Nay, and thou mouth, I'll rant as well as thou. This is mere madness, and thus a while the fit will work on him. Hear you, sir, what is the reason that you use me thus? I loved you ever, but 'tis no matter. Let Hercules himself do what he may. The cat will mew, and dog will have his day.
I pray thee, good Horatio, go after him. Strengthen your patience in our last night's speech, put the matter to the present push. Good Gertrude, set some watch over your son.
This grave shall have a living monument. An hour of quiet shortly shall we see. Till then, in patience, our proceeding be.
Near my conscience. by their own insinuation broke.
Why, what a king is this? Does it not think you stand me now upon?
He that hath killed my king, murdered my mother, popped in between the election and my hopes, thrown out his angle for my proper life, and with such cousinage, is it not perfect conscience to bring you this far? Is it not to be damned to let this canker of our nature come as further evil?
It must be shortly known to me from England what is the issue of the business there.
It will be short. The intern is mine, and a man's life's no more than to save one. But I am very sorry, Horatio, that to Laertes I forgot myself. For by the image of my cause I see the portraiture of his. I will court his favors, but sure, the bravery of his grief depends on the power of his passion.
Peace! Who comes there?
Your lordship is a right welcome back to thee.
I humbly thank you, sirs. So smell this water bottle.
No, good, my lord.
Thy stay is the more gracious.
Tis a vice to know him.
He hath much land and fertile. Tis of show, but as I say, spacious in possession of dirt.
Sweet lord, if your lordship were a leisure, I should impart a favor from his majesty.
I will receive it, sir, with all diligence of spirit.
But your bonnet to his right use, just for the head. I think your lordship is very hot.
No, indeed, it is very cold. Your wind is northerly.
It is indeed cold, my lord, indeed. But the air is very sultry and hot in my complexion. Exceedingly, my lord, it's very sultry in this term. I cannot tell how. My lord, his majesty, has made me consider that he has laid a great wager on your head.
Sir, this is the matter.
I beseech you, remember.
Nay, for my ease and defeat. Sir, you're not ignorant of what excellence Laertes has as his weapon.
What's his weapon?
Right there in his dagger.
That's two of his weapons. But well,
the king, sir, has laid service. And a pleasant passage between himself and him shall not exceed six. He has laid on 12 for 9, and will come to a wounded trial if you vouchsafe the answer.
What if I answer no?
Well, sir, the opposition of your person in trial.
I will walk through the hall. If it pleases majesty, it is the breathing time of day. A foil be brought, the gentleman willing, and the king hold his purpose. I will win for him if I can. Not much will gain nothing but my shame and be all his.
Shall I deliver it so?
Even so, sir. After what flourish your nature will.
I commend my youth to your lordship.
Yours. He does well to commend it for himself. There are no tongues else for his turn.
He will lose, my lord.
I do not think so. Since he went into France, I have been to continue the practice. That should win at the odds.
Hey, good red work,
but that was something how ill all is here about my heart.
Of course not, my lord.
It is a foolery, but it is such a sort of gain-giving as would perhaps trouble a woman.
Of course not, my lord.
If your mind is of anything, obey it. I will forestall their affair hither and tell them you are not fit.
Not a whit. You defy augury. There is a special providence in the fall of the sparrow. If it be not now, if it be not come, it will be now. If it be not now, yet it will come. The readiness is all. Since no man of all things knows what is it to leave the times, let be.
Come, Hamlet.
Come and take this hand from me.
Give me your pardon, sir. I have done you wrong, but pardon it as you are a gentleman. This presence knows, and you must needs have heard, how I am punished with a sore distraction. What I have done, that might your nature, honor, and exception roughly awake, I here proclaim was madness. Was it Hamlet wrong Laertes? Never Hamlet. Sir, in this audience, let my disclaiming from a purpose evil free me so far in your most generous thoughts that I have shot an arrow
in this case should serve me most to my revenge. But in my terms of honor, I stand aloof, and will no reconcilement till by some elder masters of known honor I have a voice and precedent of peace to keep my name on board. But till that time, I do receive your offered love like love and will not wrong it.
I embrace it freely, and will this brother's wager frankly play. Give us the foils. Come.
Come. One for me.
I'll be your foil, Laertes. In mine ignorance, your skill shall, like a star of the darkest night, strike fiery off indeed.
You mock me, sir.
No, by this hand.
Give them the foils, young Osric. As in Hamlet, you know the wager.
Indeed, my lord. Your grace has laid the odds o' the weaker side.
I do not doubt it. But since he is better, we have therefore odds. This is too heavy. Let me see another.
This likes me well. Have these foils all the length?
Aye, my lord. Set me the stoups of wine upon that table. The king shall drink to Hamlet's better breath. And in that cup an union shall he throw, richer than four successive kings in Denmark's crown have worn. Give me the cups. Come, begin. And you, the judges, bear a wary eye.
Come, sir.
Come, my lord.
One! No! Judgment!
A hit, a very palpable hit.
Well, again!
Give me drinks. Hamlet, this pearl is thine. Here's to thy health. Give him the cup.
Set it by a while, I'll play this bout first. Come, sir.
Gertrude, do not drink.
I will, my lord. I pray you pardon me.
It is the poisoned cup, it is too late.
I dare not drink it, madam, by and by.
Come, let me wipe thy face.
My lord, I'll hit him now.
I do not think it. Yet it is almost against my conscience.
Come, for the third, Laertes, you do but dally. I pray you, pass with your best violence. I'm afeard you make a wanton of me.
Say you so? Come on! Part them, darn sense.
Nay, come again! Ha! Look to the queen there, ho!
Crows my spirits. Wretched queen, adieu.
you that look pale and tremble at this chance, that are but mutes or audience to this act, had I but time, is this fell sergeant death as swift in his rest? Oh, I could tell you, but let me.
Never.
Oh, I die, Horatio. Thou livest. Report me and my cause aright to the unsatisfied.
Never believe it. More an antique Roman than a Dane. Yet, there's some liquor left.
Give me the cup. By heaven, I'll have it. Oh God, Horatio. What a wounded name, thing standing thus unknown, shall I leave behind me? If thou didst ever hold me in thy heart, absent thee from felicity a while, and in this harsh world draw thy breath in pain to tell my story. What warlike noise is this?
Young Fortinbras with conquest hath come from Poland. The ambassadors of England give this warlike volley.
Oh, I die, Horatio. I cannot live to hear the news from England, but I do prophesy the election lights on Fortinbras. He hath my dying voice to tell him, with the currents more or less which have solicited. The rest is silence.
What cracks a noble heart? Good night, sweet prince. Lights of angels singing to thy rest.
What drum comes hither? Where is this sight? What is it you would see? If a war wonder cease your search. Squire cries on havoc. The sight is dismal, and our affairs from England have come too late. The ears are senseless that should give us hearing to tell him that his commandment has been fulfilled, that Rosencrantz and Guildenstern are dead. Where should we have our thanks?
Not from his lips had the ability of life to thank thee. He never gave commandment for their death. But since, so you jump upon this bloody question. You from the Polish wars and you from England are here arrived. So give the order that these bodies high on a safe be placed into the view. Let me speak of it to the yet unknown world. How these things came to pass.
Take up the bodies.
Let the soldiers shoot.
Thank you.
can be loud. Oh, there we go. Thank you, guys. So extra special thanks to Leah, first of all, who, you know, you guys can clap for her a ton when she comes back out, but she is really, we wouldn't be here without her. This production was her vision, and she absolutely 100% realized it phenomenally.
Crazy, but I just like to thank everyone for making it possible because I couldn't have done this senior project without everyone's help. I also have some presents for Marla, Ian, and Penny. So, so first of all, we'd like to thank Penny for our amazing costumes. Yeah, so this is for you, Penny, for everything that you've done for us and these amazing costumes. And also, can we call up Elizabetta, who helped so much with costumes, and she's amazing. We'd like to thank Ian for his being the technical director of the show, and also being a fabulous Lucianus in the play. So, so for Ian. Thank you so much. And then, of course, we'd like to thank Marla, who had entrusted me with this senior project, and thank you so much. Yes. So everyone, thank you so much for coming. And would anyone else do you have something to say? Or yes?
No, I did not.
Okay. This show, what a pleasure it was to work with these students. Thank you so much for coming. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Marla Truini. I'm the director of the theater program here. And I know it's late, but I do want to take a few moments to honor the three girls who are the senior girls in the class. So if you could step forward. Come forward. It's been my honor to work with these girls since freshman year, and I'd like to give you a little sense of what they've accomplished over the past 4 years. Let's start with Vicky. So Vicky, of course, you saw her tonight as the amazing role of Claudius, which. We had her this fall in Amadeus as Constance, amazing performance. Her first female role. And last at Westover, but you rock the men. And and of course, Once Upon a Mattress, As You Like It, Seussical, Othello, Legally Blonde, and Measure for Measure. What a resume. Let's have Leah and Nichelle step forward. Of course, our amazing Hamlet. She was in last semester's production of Rent, rocking it on the stage. And of course, playing Salieri, another like momentously huge role in the fall. So what a senior year. And then, going back a little bit further, Once Upon a Mattress, As You Like It, Seussical, Othello, Legally Blonde, and Measure for Measure. Again, phenomenal. And going on to work to a professional career as an actor also, which is pretty amazing. Woo! Woo! Yeah! Woo! I mean, Amelia Bell. Step forward. So if you notice in your program, it says 12 for 12, and that is a reference to she performed in all 12 plays. Three each year from freshman year. Which I think is, it's got to be some kind of record, I don't know. So, of course, our darling and malevolent Gertrude. And then last semester, directing the production of Rent. And then the list goes on. Amadeus, Months Upon a Mattress, Eurydice, As You Like It, Seussical, Othello, Tales from the Mouth of the Golden Horsehead, Legally Blonde, Machinal, and Measure for Measure. And Amelia, again, as with all the other, with the other two, best of luck in college. I'm so thrilled to know that you're going to pursue your dream. And we're always here for you. This is your home. And speaking of being always being this the home, I wanted to acknowledge Libby Frober, who's here. She was in the cast of Hamlet in 2005 when we last did this show. So stand up, Libby. Libby played Laertes, and it was really nice to get a picture of her and Trish Collins down in my office earlier tonight. It was really fantastic that you came back. And I know that I was in touch with a lot of that cast this past week, and I'm hoping that the live stream was working tonight. And if it is, hi, everybody. We love you, and come back to Westover. We miss you. And this stage is always yours. So parents, faculty, friends, thank you so, so very much. And I know that we have some announcements about baskets, but it's very late. So do you want to get any pictures of the kids on the stage? Should we let them do that?
Okay. Thank you so much. We have two senior techies as well who are both in the booth right now, and I'm not going to make them run down because they're controlling the lights and this microphone and everything. But so much, so much love to Alex Ivanov and Rihanna Ishikawa. Rihanna and Ivanov are first and second heads of tech, and Rihanna, like me, has done all 12 shows since freshman year, and Ivanov has done, let me see if I can get this, all right, Machinal, Tales, Eurydice, kind of helped out with many more, Rent last term, and now As You Like It. I said Rent last term. Oh no, I forgot. And Rihanna also was the technical director, coordinator, set designer for Rent. They are so incredibly talented at what they do, and so much of what you see on the stage is because of them. And on that note, if I could have all of the other techies come out on stage and take a bow. I know you guys hate it when we do this, but we have to do this. Woo! Woo! And one last special thanks to Rian, who was actually not going to be doing the show this term, and then last minute came in and has been running the soundboard for the whole show. So we really, she can't leave, she can't get away.
So thank you very much. If anybody wants to take pictures, we'll leave the lights on for a few minutes and you can take pictures of your students, and then we'll see you next time, next year. Yahoo!